Okay, hello. Welcome to this presentation about how IT works. Does the microphone work? Yeah, okay. I'm Peter Martin. I'm from the Netherlands. And I'm from Nijmegen, the Netherlands. And Nijmegen is in the east of the Netherlands. It's about 28 hours from here by foot. And in this presentation, I would like to tell you something about IT. Do you know what IT means, by the way? Yes, information technology. And it's an integral part of our life, because we are using mobile phones, laptops, car navigation, etc. And I would like to start discussing what a computer is. Then I will continue until what Joomla actually is. My goal is not to be 100% accurate. I hope that if I can be 86.75% accurate, then I will be happy. Yeah. So, what I hope to accomplish is that you will end this, go away at the end of this session with an idea of what all these concepts means, and not in technical terms, but in other kinds of terms, so that you have a sort of vision about it. So the computer. Compute is actually calculate, and these people are computers. They in the past they didn't have computers or calculators, so they had logarithm tables, and these persons had to calculate those tables. And this is the first computer. It's called ENIAC. This is one of the first computers that was used just in 1947. And you see all those wires, because they had to wire to program those computers by hand. If they want to change the program, they had to rewire everything, which would take a lot of time. This is in about 1950, somewhere in the 50s. This is one of the first real computers that had a memory. And this memory was used to load a program that could make this computer work. So a general definition of a computer is it's a sort of machine, a general purpose machine. And its purpose will be defined by a program which it will run. So if you want your computer to be a typewriter, just load a program called typewriter. If you want a calculator, just load the calculator program. If you are bored, just load patience, or solitaire it's called, and still be bored. This is the IBM 360. It's one of the mainframe computers. You see, they are really huge, and these computers were really expensive. So in the past, these computers were used by a lot of people at the same time. They were multi-purpose and multitasking. Those people were working at other places on a terminal, which is a keyboard and a monitor. And they were just using it at the same time. This, of course, is very well known. Yeah. It's at the end of the 70s, a small computer called Apple II. And this computer revolutionized the computing industry, because it was the first computer that real people actually could use. And it was affordable. In the 1980s, it was known as the home computer era. This is the Commodore 64. It was my first computer. And in the 1980s, there were a lot of different computers, like the ZX Spectrum, the BBC Acorn. And these computers introduced a lot of people with computing. Another real old one, I think it was 1981. This is the first IBM PC, the 5150. And this is the basis of our modern computing technology. This was the first IBM computer, and everything was derived from it is called IBM compatible. And if you look at the computer, this is a rough scheme. There's a sensor processor unit in it. And this CPU in this case was the 8088, and this was from Intel, and it's still in, they still make these kind of CPUs, I mean modern ones. You always have a long-term memory and a short-term memory, input and output. Input can be user input, and the output will be mostly, most of the time, a monitor, but in the past it was just LEDs. The ROM, there has to be some sort of program which will load operating system, because when you have just a computer, without an operating system you can't do anything. So about the operating system, it's the second item I would like to tell about. The operating system is the central of your computer, the central heart of your computer. If you look at this scheme, this is the computer itself, the hardware. The operating system is just lying on top of it, and it's communicating between the interface and the hardware. The interface, you can have a graphical user interface or a command line interface, and those interfaces are the connection between the program and the user. And the operating system is a connection between the command line interface and the hardware. So if you are using a word processor, it's just a program, and you are typing some sentences, you are using the keyboard. The keyboard is hardware, which is, the operating system sees that you are typing, and it will give this information to the program, and also the operating system will send it to the monitor. About interfaces, these are three common known, well-known interfaces. Who has used MS-DOS? Okay, well, this is MS-DOS. Who uses Linux? This is just a Linux, but you can configure it in every color you like. Macintosh, terminal, there's this. So these are just command line interfaces. You still have those at command. Sorry? TOS? I don't know that. Instead of terminal. Oh, okay. Okay. Atari ST. Okay, yeah. So when you want to run programs like a music program on Atari, you have to type the command and enter, and then it will start the program. These days, most people use these kinds of things, the graphical user interface. This is Apple. Here you see Windows. Who uses Windows 8? Really so much? Okay, and because I'm really a Linux guy, I included a Linux, three different Linux desktops, just to see that there are a lot of Linux desktops, and it's not just command line. So, in brief, the different kinds of operating systems you have, the Unix ones, I mean Unix and Linux, those look like each other. They are not the same, but they look like each other. Unix was the operating system developed for the mainframe computer, and because you were working with multiple people at the same time, it should have been multitasking, so running different programs at the same time, but also multi-user. If one person was doing something, the other person should not be able to see what this person was doing. And this Unix was built with stability and safety in mind. Linux was made by a student called Linus Torvalds. I think he was Swedish and he was studying in Finland. He had a really old computer and he wanted to create an operating system. I mean, he liked Unix, and there was an operating system called Minix, which was a clone, and he wanted to have something like it on his computer, but his computer was too old, so he started programming himself. He released it with a letter on Usenet, saying something like, "Yeah, hello, I'm Linus, and I made this operating system. Well, it's not really going to be huge, it's just for my hobby, and if people want to contribute or want to use it, maybe feel free." It was open source, and well, we know the result. IBM, Microsoft. Microsoft came with MS-DOS. In what was the first IBM compatible computer, and in 1985 they launched Windows. But Windows was first just a GUI on top of MS-DOS. And from 1995 they developed Windows 95 and everything, what was all the newer variants. And those are a real operating system with the GUI built in. Apple, also another system. This is the Macintosh. It was the first computer that had a graphical user interface. I mean, a computer that people actually used, because the graphical user interface was not discovered or invented by Apple. It was an invention by Xerox PARC. They made copying machines, and they came up with a graphical user interface. And I think that Steve Jobs saw it over there and wanted it on his computer. It's really, in 1999, Apple came with a new operating system called OS X. X means 10, but I think it also has something to do with Unix, because it's Unix-based. And if you look at the program structure, just Unix, so it's also really very stable. Oh, wait. About Apple, who in the audience has an Apple smartphone? A smartphone of Apple, the iPhone, yes, the only one. So the other ones are using Android, I hope. Okay. Android is also Linux. And it was made by Google. It's open source. Well, not everything, because there are some drivers that are not open source. But the kernel is just Linux. And it's used for smartphones, but also in televisions at these days. So networking. Why would people want to network? I think they want to share computing power, like at the mainframe period. They might want to use the same documents, so share documents, and maybe share stuff like equipment, like printers. You don't want a printer for every person in an office. I mean, you just need one. So you have different kinds of networks. The most primitive network is this one. It's called SneakerNet. Does anyone know what SneakerNet means? Yes, you had to look sneakers because you had to walk a lot with all those removal devices. So if you look at the network, if you connect two computers with each other, you can use one cable. If you want to connect three computers with each other, you need three cables. Because if this, maybe you can use just two cables, but then this computer has to be on all the time. So the more computers you add, the more complex it gets. So in this case, I don't count it anymore, I think. But there are really a lot of connections. This is not the way to make connections. So again, Xerox PARC, they came up with a new protocol called Ethernet. And Ethernet is a protocol where you can just connect all the computers to one cable, or maybe two cables, but you don't need to connect every computer to each other. And they just broadcast information all over this network. So if this computer wants to talk to this computer, it sends some signal, and every computer receives it. But only this computer knows it's for me, so it looks to this information. That is, if this computer is owned by a hacker and they install the sniffer software, they can listen to everything. But so if you're working at a network, be careful, because people can listen all your packages if you're not using encrypted lines like HTTPS. So what happens if you have a network and you add a new machine in the network? There is always one machine, one computer, or one device. In this case, it's this router, which says something like, well, okay, I'm a DHCP, and I will give new IP addresses to all the new connections. You can also do it manually, but that's a lot of work. So this one says, hello, I'm new. And this computer says, okay, new one. From now on, I'm this address, and I will be the port to the outside world. And by the way, your name is now 42. And okay, if you want to go on the internet and you want to know domain names, just ask it to this IP address. Oh, by the way, this is already the internet protocol. Because it was so popular, the internet protocol, it's now even used at local ethernets. If you looked at internet, If you hear about the internet, you always hear the story about ARPA. ARPANET. ARPANET was made by the American Defense, and it was used for research. I mean, to connect laboratories to each other, and it should be safe. So, what is internet? I just talked about local networks like Ethernet, and if you connect two Ethernets to each other, you can have an internet. You can have an internet, because internet is a sort of inter-network. So let's assume this is Africa. I have a location over here, and I have an office in, I think, Cairo. And I want to have those communicate with each other, those two networks. I can just connect those using a wire. I can, but it will be very expensive and very unreliable, because if this one gets cut, you can't connect anymore with the other one. So you have to find out something else. In this case, internet is packet switching on TCP/IP. It's a bit technical, and I will go into details. TCP means Transmission Control Protocol, and IP is Internet Protocol. If you see that packet switching on TCP/IP is not really helpful. To explain packet switching, every communication on the network is divided in small blocks, and those blocks are called packets. Those packets can travel from one source to a destination, but they can use different routes. It doesn't matter what route, they just use a route. I come back to that later. And at the destination, the packages are merged together, and the merged one is the same as the original one. So if I go back to the Earth, I have my location here, the other location here. There are more routers here now. If I want to communicate from this office to this office, I can use packets, and the packets will be sent from this router to router, 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 but also from this router to like this way. So it doesn't matter if this way or this way, and if this router gets broken, the other route will be used for every communication. And the other advantage is this office only has to pay for this connection and this connection, because all those connections are shared. And this is why internet is so successful. They share resources. Sharing and sending in packages will also give three different problems. How do you know where to travel to? Which route do you have to take? And how do you know if a package arrives safely at the destination? So, Internet Protocol. The Internet Protocol is about addressing, so where to go to, and about the route, which is the shortest route. And the shortest route, every router in a network, in the Internet, when it gets a package, they have a sort of table, and they know which way is the shortest route to some other place. So they will just pass it to another router, which is closer to the destination. And TCP, it's the other part. This is the quality control of the internet. Every packet will be sent to a destination, and the destination will acknowledge, yes, thank you, I got this packet number 5, and then it will send packet number 6. And if at one time it didn't get acknowledgement in time, it will just resend the packet. And I say packet 1, packet 2, but it will do it in sequences. It's not just like that. It's more and more complicated. But this is just a simple version of it. So when we talk about internet, we talked about IP addresses, but IP addresses are a bit difficult. So they have DNS. You know what a DNS is? Yes. And you know what this is? Sorry? Yeah, and you know what computer you will reach? Google. Google. Yeah. No, me neither. I have to look it up. So the DNS, you can see the DNS is a phone book. We have a phone book, and we have a lot of phone numbers in it. These days we have a mobile phone and everything is in it already, but let's assume you want to phone some pizzeria in your neighborhood. You don't know the number. I hope you don't know the number from your head. So you have to look it up in the phone book. This is how computers work. When you connect to the internet, you get assigned to a DNS. So if I am connected to my local host, internet service provider, I use their DNS. And this also gives problems when you change your when you change domain to a new IP address. Maybe you are looking to the new IP address at one point in time and your customer not, so you have differences. So this is just how the DNS works. So a server. A server is just a regular computer. You can even use a Raspberry Pi, really small computer, to be a server. A server is a computer that handles requests. It serves things. And because you want to serve things all the time, you have to keep your computer on, switched on all the time. And that's not really practical. So therefore, there are hosting companies and server parks. What you see here is a server park with all these kinds of servers, and they have, I think, 4 servers in one row. There is one problem with servers. They have an IP address, and on a server they can have different processes running. So you can have a server, maybe you have your own server, and you have a website on it, you have an FTP on it, you have an email on it. So they have all the same IP address. So you might have problems with it. I mean, it's difficult to have different processes on one computer. So if you look at a house, a house is multi-user. You can use a house with multiple people. A house is also multitasking. You can have different processes running at the same time. If you look at all those processes have their own pipe or door for the house. Because if you will use the same door or pipe for every process, you will get a mess in your house. So it's the same with computers. Computers have, servers have logical ports. You might know 21, 22, these are the most common ports. And if you want to visit the website, your browser knocks on the IP address, but also knocks on port 80 without you seeing it. I mean, it does it all the time. Email. In the past, on the mainframe computers, it was possible to send small messages to other people. A message is just a small text file. And someone thought, well, okay, if someone is offline, maybe we should store it for a minute or for a couple of days. And when he gets back online, he can read it. And that was the start of email. Email is just a text file. Just plain text. And this text file has some header, and in the header is some information about where to send it to, sent it, what time, what routers did it pass, etc. So if you look at an email address, this is my email address. If I send email, or if someone sends email to this address, the dba.nl has an IP address. And without you seeing it, your email client will send this email to an SMTP, but I will show you in a minute, and it will handle it from there on. It will send it to my server, and my server will just accept it. And I have to define if there's a user Peter, to accept this email. So if you look at this example, I wanted to send an email to Bill Gates, because I'm really a bit mad about when I buy a computer, I have to pay license fees for Windows, even if I don't use Windows, because I like Linux. So I hope this is not really too harsh and that it's a bit polite. So I got a mail back from Bill, and he said, okay, I'm sorry that you don't like our operating system anymore. Please keep in mind that our next Windows version will be much better. And, well, they don't have a refund policy, but he ended his mail, P.S. I noticed that your website runs on Joomla. That's awesome. Do you know that Joomla also works on our products, Windows, EES, and MS SQL? Well, of course, it was just a dream, because I could get back something like this. This is a bounce message, but you will also only get a bounce message back when it's configured like that. They could also configure it just to throw away the email without sending a reply to me. So if you look at the different kinds of things you have to do with mail, SMTP is the mailbox you use when you send email, and you can receive email in a POP3 or in IMAP. POP3 is just like a mailbox outside of your house. You go to the mailbox, you take your mail out of it, you put it on the kitchen table, and when you pass your mailbox again, you can't read your email from there. You have to go to the kitchen table because there is your mail. IMAP is something else. You keep your mail and your send mail together, and it doesn't matter where you look at your mail, because you always look at it to the server where it's stored. WWW, the internet, not. World Wide Web, that's where WWW stands for, and it's the Hypertext Transfer Protocol, the HTTP you always see in the browser. It's not the internet, of course, we know that. But a lot of people say, yeah, I read on the internet that, and then they read something on the World Wide Web. World Wide Web is just a collection of HTML documents, which are text files, again, plain text files. And those text files have markup language inside. And this markup language can link it to other documents. If you're visiting a web browser, I mean a website, you're not visiting a website. Because you don't visit the website. The only thing you do, you sit behind your computer, you type in an address like joomla.org, and your browser connects to the server of Joomla, and because it's HTTP, it gets the index from Joomla, and it's an HTML document. It will be sent to your computer in your cache memory. So yeah, I'm afraid that you are not visiting any website, you're just reading documents at your own computer. And if you do it with HTTP, it's not secure because it's just plain text. If you're using HTTPS, it's encrypted. But if you give information to another server using HTTPS, and the server is unsecure, HTTPS can't save you. HTML is just a text file with markup. And this markup will define what a certain element in your text means. And your browser will interpret it and use it for something like a hyperlink. Your browser makes a hyperlink of a hyperlink. It's just plain text. Images are not in your HTML. Images, there are only references to images in your HTML. CSS is just plain text again. JavaScript, okay. Website. I told you about HTML and about markup language. And a website is just a server that can get requests for web pages. And it will send just plain text with HTML code in it. You can have different servers, like dedicated servers, shared hosting, VPS. Who has a dedicated server? Okay, who has a VPS? Shared hosting. Okay. So if you dedicated means you have just one rack, you hire the whole rack and you pay for the whole rack. Only also if you just need 1% of it, you pay the 100%. It's really expensive, but you are really flexible in configuration. You can install Nginx as web server if you like. You can't do that with shared hosting. Shared hosting, you have one server rack and you just rent a part of it, a really small part. And I say maybe you can share it 100, but it could also be 500. You don't know, only your hosting know.
I heard that there's a website where you can check with how many in shared plan. Yeah. Neighbors, IT neighbors, and that you can see with how many people you're sharing your sites or not.
Yeah, that's not really reliable, because in Holland, I use a hosting provider called Byte, and they have a cluster. So every customer has the same IP address, and within you have just another server. So, and they have load balancers, etc. So it's not really reliable. Yeah, cloud hosting is something else. It's not really shared. I know.
But it is another idea of sharing with other
accounts. Yeah, I know. I know. Yeah. Let me get back to that. So it's nice because it's cheap, but you use the same configuration as all the other websites on the same server. So you can't make any changes regarding that. If your neighbor gets hacked, or if it's a really popular website, it will have negative impact on your performance of your website. VPS means virtual private machine. And with the VPS, you have parts of a large server. You just rent a sort of space, but you don't know on which server the space is. It doesn't mind. You can also see it as cloud hosting. But with virtual machine, you have the whole machine yourself, and you can install your own operating system or your own web server, etc. And with cloud hosting, you just have shared hosting in a sort of cloud, so you have all pieces, and it's really scalable. There are two different ones. You can just have managed hosting, and your hosting company asks you money for every month, and they will do the updates for Linux. Or can do everything yourself, and then it's called unmanaged. A static website, just HTML website, has HTML files, text files, CSS, also text files, and images. And yeah, of course, you need an FTP and local editor to make changes. If you do something with a dynamic website, like a Joomla website, you use PHP as a scripting language, and MySQL. The scripting language creates HTML files, which is sent to the browser of the visitor. And it can retrieve information from your database. This is PHPMedmin, I think you all know it. The more complicated CMS systems are programmed using object-oriented programming. And object-oriented program is the almost last part of this presentation. This is difficult. Object-oriented programming. An object is a variable, and it can contain other variables. It can contain functions, which are methods, and it's reusable. You can reuse it. You can reuse other people's classes in your project. And when you use it, you don't know the inner working of the class, but you know how to use the class. This is really difficult. So I came with this idea. I like baking cake. And if I bake cake, this is the recipe I use. These are all the ingredients. And these ingredients, I have to do this procedure to bake cake. I don't go into the details too much. But in short, I just add stuff. I mix it. And I get dough, and I put the dough in the oven for 55 minutes, and it will be cake. In this story, I have two objects. My oven is an object, and my mixer is an object. Because I can use this mixer by hand. I can use this mixer. It's a hand mixing. Or I can use this stand mixer. It doesn't matter. You put stuff in it, and you mix it, and you get the dough. So I don't have to know the inner working of this machine, or if I'm the human of this machine, I don't know the inner working of it. And I can replace this mixer for this one. I don't hope it's needed, but so I don't know I know the variables that I have to put into it. I know how much mixing time I have to put into it, and I know what to expect. Dough. And the dough I put in the oven. And that's already told it. So I have this recipe I just showed you, and this recipe I can make into an object. A class, a reusable class. And my daughter, she had her birthday recently, and she wanted to create a Hans and Gretel candy. So a small house of candy. And what she did, she asked me for, "Daddy, could you bake a cake for me?" And I was the object. She just asked for cake. And I did all the ingredients in the mixer and in the oven. And I got the cake out and we left her the cake. So now I was the object. And what I did, I helped her with sugar, icing sugar. So she had a sort of glue. And then she decorated it. This is the cake. And this is the result. And this is the result after the party. So this is how object-oriented programming works a bit. And if you look at coding, I don't know how PDFs are created. I don't know. I know where to download a class of PDF. And I know how to instantiate that class. Like I first require it, and then I say, I want to have a new object of this PDF class. I add a page. I add some font. I say, hello, Joomla. I put some text in it. And with output, the PDF is created. I don't know the inner working of the PDF. I just can use it with this kind of code. This is object-oriented programming. So finally, Joomla. If you go to joomla.org, there is a definition, and the definition says, Joomla is an award-winning content management system, blah, blah, blah. If you go to the developer website, you see something like, Joomla is a framework, a foundation to build web applications. If you go to other pages on the Joomla website, you see Joomla is a project, a community-driven project. And after creating this presentation, I was thinking about Joomla is a sort of operating system. Joomla is a sort of operating system between the web server and third-party components. Because Joomla only exists because there are components, the core components or components you install in Joomla. The components determine what happens on the page. So it's a sort of operating system. But you can also see Joomla as a GUI, a graphical user interface. It's a graphical user interface between the administrator of the website and the information he puts or she puts into the database. And the graphical user interface of Tree is called Isis. And so it can be seen as a graphical user interface for admins, but also for visitors, a graphical user interface. Because visitors visit your website, well, not really, they ask for files. And they get information from your database. So it's a sort of GUI between the visitor and your database. And the visitor's GUI is determined by you if you install a website. So please create a nice, friendly GUI so that it's easy to get information from your database. So this is how IT works in very general terms. I hope that you learned something about computers, operating systems, what happens if you connect computers, what happens if you connect different networks, what a server is, what email means, www, that is not the internet, that you know what a website is. Well, I think you already knew that. That you have a better common knowledge about object-oriented programming, and that I like baking cake. And, of course, that Joomla is whatever you make it. So I hope that I didn't demystify stuff about IT. Are there any questions? Okay, thank you.